Okay, so this is now the fourth seminar of the seminar series on cognitive robotics offered by Queen Mary University of London. And today I'm extremely happy to introduce Professor Giulio Sandini, who is professor at the University of Genoa and is also director at the Italian Institute of Technology. And he will tell us more about that. I've been knowing Giulio for a very long time, and he's actually the person who drove me to research in the very first place when I was myself a master's student at the university. And I was interested in robotics, but I still didn't know what robotics was. And I started talking with Giulio a few times, and I realized that was amazing and something I wanted to do. And especially this approach of looking at human intelligence and try to get smart ideas on how we could make a robot more useful for ourselves. And so I hope this, and I'm sure this talk will be also inspiring for many of you in the audience. And without further waiting, I will leave the floor now to Giulio. Thank you very much for accepting the invitation.
Oh, okay, Lorenzo. Yes, we go a long way back, even before master thesis, as you know very well. But yeah, I mean, it is a pleasure to be here with you, and I want to thank you very much for the invitation. You know, it's one of the important things for an old professor like myself, you know, is to see that his past pupils are growing, and going on, somehow, you know, following the path that was shown initially, you know. So I'm very happy to accept your invitation and see that the lab where you are and your group are continuing on the stream that we started together, and that you contributed very much to carry on during the years when we worked together. So this is basically what I want to tell you now is the goal of the talk, more or less. No, what I want to do with you is to discuss a few research topics related to familiarity somehow. Familiarity is one of the topics that I will touch, not the only one, but you know, how it is possible to establish a sort of long-lasting attractive relationship between robots and humans, you know. Along this path, I will try to explain also why we need a cognitive architecture to follow to guide the research we are interested in. So in some sense, you know, I will not provide any solutions, but just you know, things to think about, you know, if you or for whoever is interested in studying a human robot interaction and human interaction. And you know, as you said, I am starting from a very biased point of view, which dates back many years, and that is that I'm using robots to study humans, basically. You know, it's you know, this virtuous loop, you know, of using robots to understand humans to build robots. So this is you know, the very strong link between artificial systems and neuroscience. So the outline, more or less, the topics that I will touch are developmental robotics, and a little bit of what we missed along the path. In my view, I will talk about familiarity with robots, as I was anticipating, somehow the origin of social science, you know, that we exchange when we communicate, so the time frame of sociality somehow, and a little bit about deep learning and evolution. So it's a very thick list of topics, but I wanted to present all of them because there is a fil rouge between them that I think it is important. This is the main message of what I want to tell you, besides, you know, the individual aspects. I will also show some examples of our latest research, but this last part is not really the most important. So, developmental robotics is something we started many years ago with the idea of trying to understand if by looking at human development we could draw some suggestions about how to develop intelligent robots. You know, and the way we did it was to try to maintain anthropomorphism, not only in the shape of the robot, but also in its functions, you know, implementing control using what is known about human motor control and so on and so forth for vision. So along the years, we actually developed many robots, not as many, but I mean these are the three most important robots we have been working with, and I'm sure Lorenzo remembers very well James. You know, he played and did very interesting things with James for a few years when he was a PhD student at IIT. So this it was a sort of a big evolution. The baby bot was assembled by putting together commercial parts. You know, James was the first tendon-driven humanoids, half humanoid design, and then since 2008 we have this the ICAB robot. So we were interested in studying the process of building an intelligent system, so or better, you know, how a system builds itself, you know, builds its own intelligence. And you know, the bodies that we have been developing are still very much improving. You know, these are some of the latest demonstrations that we have about the sensor and about the kind of movement and control we have been working with. And along these years, we have been working on a lot of learning, you know, a lot of individual learning. You know, Lorenzo participated in some of these, so learning how to control gaze, learning how to contrast gravity, proprioception, effects of actions. So this was all done with this baby bot robot. But then, you know, later on, we continued using ICAB, we dig very much into this idea of learning, you know, learning different things, learning affordance, learning to see it, learning to name objects, to repeat actions, so on and so forth. So it's a lot of individual learning, and certainly since we started working with the robot, you know, certainly we have robots now getting much closer to us. You know, I don't have to go into the details of the individual pictures. I'm sure you know all these very nice humanoids that are designed by Hiroshi Ishiguro and many others in the world. And you know, if you look at these pictures, and if citizen, not scientific, nor robotic citizen, looks at what you see on television and what you read on newspaper, sometimes it looks like we are very close to delivering, you know, something like you know, personal robots, and many commercial attempts have been made to produce personal robots, but as a matter of fact, you know, almost all of them have failed, you know, and there is a stream of articles appearing in different magazines where they try to explain why they this idea of personal robot is not working, and also this idea of the cobots, you know, the a robot collaborating with the human industry, did not fly so far. I mean, and I think the main reason why it didn't fly is that, you know, when people were reading about Cobot was thinking about robot working with humans, while what is offered now is robot working next to humans. So this there is something missing here, you know, there is something missing here. And what do we miss, you know, for personal robot to really become assistive robots, you know, considering that it is, in my view, one of the most difficult problems to be solved from the engineering point of view. So it's not easy. Even a smaller advancement is very important. Well, the reason I think is that we need you know, a better balance between athletic abilities of robots and their ability to understand. Interaction and communication between machines and robots didn't jump, you know, like for the robot from a hopping robot to something like Atlas now. We are still very much in communication. We are still very much exploiting the fact that the human mind is adaptable. So we learn the technology's own language, and then we can interact. But certainly, you know, there is a big mismatch between acting and understanding. And most of the failures of personal robots are due to exaggerated expectations about the ability of the robots or the device, you know, to understand what is going on around it, and not about, you know, its ability to move or to sense, you know, and so developmental robotics, we started with the idea of developmental robotics. Now we discover there is this big mismatch between acting and understanding in the robotics. So we can ask, you know, how far did the idea of developmental robotics go? I mean, where are we now in this, you know, this idea? It sounded very nice and somehow not easy, but, you know, pursuable. But you know, after about 20 years, we have been working on that. We certainly had big advances, but not really in some of the features that we think are important for development. You know, and as everybody, you know, we did our own mistakes. You know, and. I will start with one, with the first one, which I think is, you know, scientifically speaking, the most important one. You know, in all these pictures I've shown with this lot of learning, individual learning that you have seen before, we have somehow implemented what I call the stroboscopic view of development, you know, where individual abilities specific for a developmental age are frozen, you know, without considering the continuity of development, the fact that there is an incremental change is not a jump. You know, there is this this idea that comes from Piaget work that development is broken down into stages. You know, and we sort of stress that as if stages were really what development is all about. While this is not the case. I mean, we certainly underestimated the role of social interaction as a tool to tune our internal models. You know, this the theory of Lev Vygotsky, who proposed this zone of proximal development. You know, he shifted the idea of stages into something more dynamic. So it is not important what you know now, but it is important where you can go from what you know. So it's the incremental aspect of development. Again, it's not a static, frozen status of world development. And you know, this all evolution, this all developmental stage are driven by social interaction. This is this is something, you know, Vygotsky was putting a lot of emphasis on imitation learning, you know, the fact that you learn by looking at your peers, you know, and I found this funny movie which shows that it's not that easy very often, you know, so you may know the principles, but then you have to try it yourself to see if it works, you know. But if you take all these things together, so the underestimation of mutual understanding, the underestimation of the continuity of development and social interaction, and also the underestimation of social interaction, somehow prevented or did not allow, did not put emphasis on the study of the development of social relationship. So it's we concentrated on sensory motor skills development, not very much on social relationship. Just one thing. When I say we, I mean the group I'm working with. I mean, others may have followed this path before, but when I talk about mistakes, I'm talking about my own mistakes, not my mistakes in general. So what I think we need to do now is to need a focus on the ontogeny of social relationship. You know, we need to address explicitly how we develop an internal model of each other, you know, how the perception of others changes, you know. Keeping in mind that a social relationship needs time to develop, you know, it changes a long time along your own life. It's a circle, it changes, you know, and the fact that, you know, social relationship is built through familiarization, you know, so in order to build a social relationship, we need time, if we need time, we need to concentrate on how to exploit the familiarity to promote an attractive relationship. Which are the bodily features and cognitive abilities needed to go beyond a sort of usefulness-driven relationship with a robot? You know, somehow, you know, how to develop the liking of being with a robot? You know? So, in short term, you know, going beyond Roomba, which is, you know, you interact with Roomba, but that. It's because it's useful, not because you like to interact with humans. So the issue of familiarity, you know, familiarity in general, it means, you know, getting used, getting familiar with, you know, so it does not include any qualitative, in principle, does not include any qualitative connotation, you know. The familiarity can promote, in fact, attraction or repulsion, you know. And attraction, yes, it is a valenced affective and cognitive ability. So we need to see how we can work with the robots to develop features that will be attractive for humans, you know, somehow, you know. And familiarity with personal robot does not promote attractiveness, you know, not a lasting attractiveness, you know. People get bored too early, and while, you know, if you want to talk about personal robots, you need to be the robot to be more than an electric appliance. And so what is about familiarity? How can you describe, how can you thinking of implementing familiarity into a robot? And, you know, I found this rather interesting article. It's not very easy, but, you know, it's an interesting article because it addresses formally the issue of how you can, what are the features that allows familiarity to develop into repulsion or attraction. You know, it's a dual possibility. You know, and what they say in this article is that the effect of familiarity depends on both time, of course, the stage again, stage of familiarity, but also the nature and the quality of the relationship. And it is formalized quite well, in my view, explaining the process through three relationship stages and three principles, which I will go very rapidly through just to try to convey this idea of what familiarity is. So if we talk about the relationship stage, you know, these three relations, the first one is very easy, is what they call awareness stage. You know, you don't know who the person is, but you have really interacted with the person. You know? So is the example they put forward is you might see a fellow student in a classroom and know she is enrolled in the class too, but you've never talked to her. So this is very initial stage. You know, you just met a robot in front of a robot, you know, kids or other important person. Just the first one. This is a sort of an easy stage, let's say, you know. The second one is what they define as the surface contact stage. So you have interacted a little bit with the person, but you still don't know if you want to build a relationship with the person. So in the case of the iCub, you know, it may be the Red Bull demo, as we call it. You know, a person is given a Red Bull and put in front of the iCub, and the iCub tries to reach for the ball. Okay, so this is a sort of a surface contact. You still don't know what the robot is able to do. Ideally, you would need to arrive to a mutuality stage, what they call the mutuality stage. You know, by this stage, you are not you are in an established relationship that is interdependent. So you depend on each other. There is a mutual exchange of utility of whatever it is, but it's mutuality here, you know. And you know, if it is mutual, it is not personal. You know, it's just and for robots, this is still science fiction. You know, as far as I know, there is no robot which can demonstrate, you know, in a significant way this, you know, sort of mutual understanding, apart from examples. You know, there are some examples, but not very much deep into the process. So these are the stages. You know, what about the quality of the relationship? You know, and to explain the quality of the relationship, they propose these three principles. You know, of familiarity. You know, that can contribute to promote attractiveness or repulsion. So they can work one way or the other. You know, so the first principle is what they call informational coherence. You know, information coherence refers to the extent to which individuals can readily integrate the information they acquire about the target person. I mean, it sounds like a complex principle, but it is not. You know, they talk about cognitive fluency, which refers basically with the fact that you interact with someone, this person can react in such a way that it fits the image that you have built of that person. So it's a fluent kind of cognitive information that is coming. I have a picture which depicts this. So if you see a person which shows some kind of features, any kind of features, you know, and you have this idea that the world is blue and the person is red, I mean, it doesn't fit. Okay, so this is not fluent while you build a relationship. This is something that doesn't fit very well in the relationship we are building with someone else. I think this is an important point. The second principles is what they call experiential saturation. You know, so which is related to the fact that familiarity can undermine attraction, you know, by increasing boredom or disgust. You know, this is what we have to escape. You know, for robots. You know, this you know the saturation can be reached in different ways, and that can be related to not only the person but also the environment where the person is working, but certainly this is what I mean, this is what robot bees today. I mean, this is a critical principle. We get saturated very easily, you know. Saturation is reached whenever the robots behave in a sort of a repetitive way. It does not change. It does not offer any novelty during the interaction. You know, does not evolve with the partner. So the robot may still be useful, you know, and like Roomba, but it does not go beyond the level of an attractive appliance. You know, and so this saturation aspect, saturation threshold, I think is what we have to try to overcome with our robot. The last principle, which is again related to mutuality, you know, is what they call the structural interdependence, you know, which is the extent to which two individuals have frequent and strong and diverse influences on each other, you know, and this structural interdependence can be measured in terms of its strength, you know, how much the relationship influences others' behavior, everyday's behavior, but also diversity. I mean, if the number of the activities are the number of activities small, then you know this structural interdependence does not really work. You know, if you interact with someone which can only brew you a cup of coffee, you know, it can be nice for a while, but then you'd like to have a pint of beer, and then you know the interest drops very, very fast. So, which kind of abilities must the robot have, you know, to establish this familiarity attraction link? You know, it has to reach cognitive fluency to avoid reaching the thresholding, the saturation thresholding, and then go to the mutuality level, you know, where to influence each other. Which are, I made just a list of, you know, attraction affording features which I think a robot should have. The first, I think, is the most important, is that the robot must remember past interaction, you know, while building a relationship and being able to interact prospectively, you know, so being able to change its behavior according to what the person it's interacting likes or doesn't like. This is related to memory, which I think is the key component of cognition in general. So the second one is that the robot must be transparent to meet expectation. You don't want the robot to behave in such a way that it surprises. It has to be understandable, you know, this idea of a cognitive fluency, you know, fit in the picture that you are building of the robot itself. Somehow I think that the robot should display some human weaknesses, you know, make mistakes from time to time, and of course not dangerous ones, but you know, try to build a relationship which is not only between God and man, but you know, between two human beings somehow, you know. And last but not least, there are two more, you know. This the robot must have a value system. This is very hard, you know, and act according to a hierarchy of values. I mean, they do not need to be very, very complex, very sophisticated, you know, but there must be some kind of a value system acting when the robot has to take a decision, and also the robot must be able to understand intentions and feelings, you know, and behave anticipatorily. So this, I mean, of course, this it's a very complex wish list, you know, and it's work for many years of PhD and postdoc students, but we don't really need to develop all of them 100%, you know, but I think that these sort of principles should guide the direction we take when we do research, you know, to go toward robots able to understand intentions or robots with a value system, you know, and start from there and go on, you know. So to promote attractiveness, the robot must be able to build a personalized model of a human and of itself. You know, this, I will come back to this in a while, and this has to be done by breaking this famous loop between action and perception, by putting also in the loop intention and experience, and you know, this is this is one of the drawings that I use most often in my talks, because if you think instead of a perception action into a loop between exploration and prediction, I think it puts you in a different frame of mind when you think about cognition, and certainly it makes evident the fact that to study to develop robots able to act prospectively, you need to study the role of internal models and structural internal models, you know, that were proposed in the past. You know, this, if you are interested in this in these aspects of cognition, I mean, the work of Marc Jeanneret on the mental simulation theory is a very good one to read. I mean, it's not a very recent one, but it has a very important content. And you know, and along this line, it's not new. I mean, in science, when you get your white hairs, you understand that is very hard to find something really new. You know, everything is an evolution. And in fact, in this respect, you know, this research stream of predictive coding and, you know, and active inference, which started, in fact, this idea of predictive coding started back in, you know, 1997 by Rao and Ballard, and now it's still continuing with Friston, with Yung Tani, with Yuki Nagai. So it is an important way of looking at cognition, which derives from this idea of moving from sensing perception action to a more exploration prediction. So, but how can you address this, all these aspects? I've been talking about memory, talking about prediction, sensory motor coordination, memory, you know, all these things. How can you put all these things, you know, somehow together, you know? Well, I think you know, we need to address this issue at a higher level, you know, at the level of a cognitive architecture. You know, that's you know, somehow it is a keyword, but it's also a way of acting, you know. And this not very recent but still very interesting article by David Vernon on the relationship between this idea of development and cognitive architectures. So I think if you are interested in these topics, this is a nice article to read, which is an evolution of this book that was written by the same three authors during the Robot Cab project in 2011. So he makes a list of this. I will not go into this list of desiderata that David is mentioning, but certainly if we talk about attractive relationship, maybe the priorities may be reshuffled a little bit, you know. And one that I think it is very important is what David calls constitutive autonomy, which relates not only to the autonomy in acting, but also in changing itself. So the robot has to become more master of itself, you know, being able to adapt its own abilities. So, brief recap. I mean, I have about 20 minutes to talk, so relax a little bit, drink a little bit if you need. But I think, you know, so far we have been talking about a mismatch between ethic and understanding. We have been talking about some dynamics of development. We've been talking about ontogeny of social interaction and the abilities, you know, this familiarity attraction link, and to arrive to this idea of a need of, for a cognitive architecture. But where do we go from here? Of course, I mean, in this period of history of science, you know, you need to ask this question, you know, is there a role for deep learning? You know, is this big data a way to achieve intelligent systems? I mean, this is a very important question to ask. So, which you can reverse by asking yourself, which role has deep learning? So I subscribe with this sentence by Judea Pearl, you know, that I personally don't like opacity, you know. Deep learning has to this defect that does not explain, you know, the results somehow. So I personally don't like opacity, so I won't spend my time on deep learning. But I know that there is a place in the, it has a place in the makeup of intelligence. You know, so even if it does not explain in general, you know, now there are streams of research talking about explainable AI, which are trying to overcome this problem. But certainly, somehow, you know, and strictly speaking, it is an old view of how the brain works, and certainly it is weak on generalization and transfer, you know, and this is a sentence by Joshua Benjo, who was one of the, let's say, inventor of deep learning. So I mean, it does not transfer, you know, and considering that, you know, when you learn to use your hand, is basically you have learned how to use all the tools that we are now using. So there must be a way of transferring abilities learned from one situation to another. And the other big problem with deep learning is that it does not really address causation very well. You know, again, Judea Pearl says that causality encodes the invariant elements of the world, which is important. Is one, I mean, to finding the invariance in the world is important. And Joshua Benjo says that we need machines that can discover causal models. So, in synthesis, you know, this idea that assembling a set of intelligent solutions by learning task-specific representation using large-scale data does not work, does not produce an intelligent system. So it does not really, I mean, this Swiss Army knife approach is what I'm saying, you know, this is a good idea, well, this is maybe a better one, but this really doesn't work. So we are back to the slides I've already shown, that we need to refer to a big picture, you know, and we need to refer to a cognitive architecture. And this, again, is not a new. If you look at this recent paper by Kotzeruba and Tsotsos, you know, they list more than 80 cognitive different cognitive architectures. Here is also the ICAB one, which we designed a little bit time ago. So how do we approach this process of building a cognitive architecture? Well, you can do it. You can do it in different ways, but you know, how do you relate deep learning and development, and how you put evolution into the equation? You know, we should consider explicitly the fact that human adaptation is based on different time frames. So some of them are millions of years, you know, or 100 millions, 100,000 years. Some of them are seconds, you know. All these, you know, evolution, development, learning, they all act at different time scales, you know, and somehow we are using often the same tools, which may not be correct. You know, some aspects of mental representation are innate. You know, which does not mean that you have them for free. I mean, but at least for robots. But you know, we have to consider some of these aspects. You know, the relationship between learning and evolution. I mean, this is a rather old paper, but you know, it has some important contents. And in fact, you know, a more recent one explaining why how learning can change the course of evolution. So, evolution somehow can be affected at shorter term, you know, at shorter term by taking into consideration the role of epigenetics, you know, things that can modify the way the genetics affect the development of abilities, you know. So it does not really change the DNA, but it change how, you know, this genetic code is expressed during evolution. So there are aspects which are important, you know, in order to identify the blueprints selected by evolution. You know, this is, again, another recent articles, you know, which says that these blueprints have been selected by evolution over 100 million of years, operating on countless quadrillion individuals. So the question here is, you know, that maybe the source of big data is not on, you know, everyday experience, but is on evolutionary implementation. And if this is true, then deep learning may be an important part of the solution in the framework of developmental robotics. You know, maybe so far we have been trying to learn too much, you know, and sometimes with the wrong tools. So maybe maybe deep learning could be a better approach to obtain these blueprints that we are referring to in the articles before. You know, what you have at time zero. You know, maybe you have to get that through evolutionary mechanisms and not through mechanisms which are good to describe evolution. So what I'm saying is that we need to harmonize the different time scales and tools, you know, and decide which one are best for each individual adaptation skills that we implement, you know. So we may be back to the you know, old debate, all of nature versus nurture, which is certainly true, but we may go back to analyzing this process from more, let's say, computational engineering point of view, you know, more besides, you know, the psychological and evolution and developmental aspects. Also considering the fact that, you know, social science can be, are in fact very often, you know, side effects of evolution. You know, there is this concept of exaptation, you know, which is which defines the process by which features acquire functions for which they were not originally adapted. So adaptation and exaptation. I mean, it sounds like you know, sort of to some of you, it may sound like a strange word and a strange concept, but certainly, you know, the social sign we use on biological motion is an exapted function. It did not evolve to produce a social sign. You know, they evolved to make our muscles stronger and not consuming too much energy. But at the end, you know, they end up with muscles which, when they contract, they generate movement with features that can be used to transmit messages. You know, another example, which is very close to my heart for past research that I did, is that the social use of gaze, you know, when you look at something which is interesting to you, and you move your eyes, is a function which derives from the fact that our retina is phase variant, small pixels in the center, big pixels in the periphery. This saves the system a lot of computational power and a lot of neurons, you know, a huge amount of neurons. But on the other hand, it forces you to move the eyes to places where there is some interest. And this can be used as a social sign. Facial expression also, people say that are exacted function of aerodigestion. I mean, as we are made, you know, the primary problem of aerodigestive system is ensuring that the air goes in the lungs and the fluids and food goes in the stomach. And this requires a quite sophisticated motor control and a big number of muscles. Okay, so then these, you know, they can also be used for convey social messages. But, you know, so, and then if you go on like that, you end up with a list of sort of evolutionary priors that can be, could be implemented in the system, could be learned by a system without really interacting in the world in real time. And then the same is true for social skills, you know. Social skill priors, you know, which are important because they bootstrap social interaction, you know, are basically represented by disposition towards human features, you know, face-like features, the sound of voice, biological motion, you know, emotional state, smell, all these kind of things are, all of them convey some social messages. And if you put them all together, this motivates the use of a full humanoid. You need a humanoid because you can send social messages in many different ways, exploiting all body parts or most of the body parts. So, using robots to understand humans, we are back to this issue, and the idea of using humanoids to study how to promote an attractive relationship. What do we have to do? I'm going fast now. I will leave the slides to Lorenzo in case you miss some of the references I am including now. But what we need to do is we need to exploit the body that we have, you know, the body that the robot has, you know, to investigate the dual role of actions. It's not only collaborating, now should be clear, but it's also communication, you know, exchanging messages. Some of them are implicit, you know, some of them are explicit, you know, like pointing with the finger is an explicit, while implicit is the movement of your eyes to a place where your attention is driven. And you need these to reach a shared goals, you know, and communicate intentions to each other. And this is, again, another slide I use almost always to show that you know, explicit and implicit messages can be exchanged really in a lot of different ways if you have a body. So the embodiment aspects of social interaction is here, you know, in these messages that you can convey. And the role of vision is then dual. It's important, you know, vision is used to acquire spatial information to execute actions, but also is used to acquire social messages. So where do you start from? Which messages do you start with? Well, I mean, evolution, I was talking about evolution, I was talking about the body. So certainly a priority, at least this is the one we pursued, is on bodily based, genetically based features, you know, these exacted functions I was referring to you before, which are related not to an act of will, but are related to the fact that our body is built like that and our world is obeying gravity laws and other laws, you know, so they are implicit and they are exploited very much. So biological motion, everybody, a lot of people knows this experiment by Johansson where he showed this, if you move dots in a human-like way, you know, the body comes out. But you can make it more complex. You can move, you can see dots like these, you know, going around an object. You don't see the object, but you know what the object is. You can perceive the object. So movement is important. You know, movement conveys emotions, you know, even if, I mean, the body part here is essential. You know, if this was not a human-like or biological-like puppet, it would not convey the same emotion that it is conveying. And all these, and some of these abilities are really innate. You know, people imitate, the children imitate when they are very, very young. You know, very simple imitation. But so the question here that we ask ourselves since many years now is, how does our visual systems transform this, you know, visual motion into objects, a human body, emotion? You know, how can you do that? I mean, and this is what the group at IIT is doing. You know, it's a multidisciplinary, multi-unit group. A few years ago, Lorenzo was among them. Now he has his own group. But the goal is still there. You know, this is the fact that this gender balanced group was not pursued. It came out like that because there is, in my view, in some sense, there is no need to try to balance, even if we do it, if we want and if we have to do it. But if you want an healthy research group, you end up with a gender balanced group. That's what I wanted to say. So it's a teamwork. And, you know, I will go very fast through some of the examples of the research that we did. You know, the fact that the robot's motor behavior affects the way human perform their own tasks. So just by looking at the robot moving in some way, and you can exploit, as I was saying, the regularity of biological motion, the fact that we have elastic muscles, you know, to isolate, to distinguish between biological and non-biological movement, you know, even in situation where you don't see the body of the human itself, or, you know, you are just using a tool. This is related to the fact that we have a body and that we have actuators which are made with the physical muscles, you know. And then the fact that visually you can detect these measures. So let me go very fast through here. You know, the fact that you can use exploit velocity profiles to basically see the weight of an object. So you can see forces because of the fact that you have a body made of muscles and so on and so forth. So this embodiment, in my view, is exactly this, is related to this. I hear some noise. I'm almost finished. I'm almost finished. So bear with me a few more minutes. But I mean, if you want the references of these articles, you go at the IIT site. There are all the publications are listed there, and you just enter, you know, the word of Alessandra Sciutti, Francesco Rea, and you end up with most of the articles I've been showing. But anyway, you can also study, you know, how you can distinguish between a movement, a hangry movement, and a safe and a healthy and a happy movement. You know, these are very nice parallels with humans also in this. So everything we are doing, it's a jump between the study of humans and the implementation of robots. I did not make it explicit this time, but all these articles that you see, if you go and look. They are both, let's say, psychological studies, experiments, and robots, robotics implementation. So reading expressions, personalization, trust, these are other topics that people in the lab is addressing. But the last few slides, you know, I want to spend just very, very few slides, you know. I want to say that, you know, although you read very often that, you know, improving robot body is still an important aspect of robotics, certainly. But what I think is that really disruptive technology will be linked to relational skills and not gymnastic skills. So robots behaving and as predictable machine, basically. And I also believe that we need to address in parallel how to advance robot technology and how to extend our knowledge about human by moving from models able to describe what is going on to models able to explain what are the principles. If you are looking for new technologies, you have to reach the level where you study the principles, move away from a pure biomimetism. You know, biomimetism may be a step, but you don't have to stay there. And this is very hard because this means that academia needs to nurture the formation of an extended research community, including not only engineers and physicists, but you know, artists and you know, philosophers, mathematicians. I mean, this is really an important. You need to join the forces of groups, and this is, I mean, people with white hairs living in academic environment knows that this is very hard. This is really very hard because the barriers are there, have been there since many years. So, in order to try to overcome this barrier, we recently started this initiative at IIT. We called it ICOG, you know, with the idea of addressing really cognitive architecture. Study how the components of the cognitive architectures can be, what are and how they can be put together and implemented. If you are interested, by the way, this is the reference of Anna Tanevska, who's the person working this specifically on this. And as we already have some talks recorded on our website, and together with David Vernon and the group at the Bremen University, we are organized this workshop, which is going to be the end of March, on cognitive architectures for robot agents. If you read the list of speakers and panelists, you may know that I think it's going to be very interesting, by the way. Okay, so this is just some publicity, and the last slide is just a recap. You know, able to understand ontogeny of social relationship, familiarity, time scale of adaptation, big picture, accepted origin of social sign, but most important of all, you know, be fair with society when you describe your results, and also open up to other communities. And with this, I finish up, and I thank you for your attention. If there are questions, I'm happy to reply. Thanks.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Giulio. It was I think it was great. A lot of interesting ideas, and I like that since the beginning of your talk you said you're not going to provide many solutions but even more questions. I think that's very interesting for the audience to, you know, open minds and
but it's also, Loretta, it's also easier to ask questions than to
Okay, I saw in the chat there was a question about, so you spoke about this familiarity attraction and in general, let's say, social robot, let's say. And in the chat there was a question about robotic pets that are, some of them available already in the market, and some people seem to cherish the relationship that they can get with the robotic pets. And that I think that could be at home or even in care facilities, for example. So, yeah, so I don't know if you have a comment about that and about the level of those can be useful. And
yes, no, I think, you know, all these, when you say all, it's never true because there may be an exception. But let's say the great majority of these robot pets are boring after a while. I mean, that's the big issue, you know. So people is interested, you know, because if you see a robot with a human-like shape, you know, You are interested in exploiting, you know, how close to a human the robot is. So you started interacting, and you even try to adapt your behavior to what you think is the level of understanding of the robot. So you really, I mean, try desperately to have a relationship with these robots. But then I think you soon realize that the level, is the level of understanding, which is very, very, very small. I mean, after a while, you understand that there are, you know, 30, 50 words that the robot is understanding, and you use all of them.
Yeah.
So you do that, and you continue to interact, but, you know, it does not really develop an attraction in some sense. It's more like, you know, a utility relationship. So if it is useful, I use it. Mm-hmm. But
so in that sense, maybe let's say a pet robot will generate maybe less expectation with respect to a humanoid robot. So maybe that can also be one reason why some of those pet robots, they can keep the interaction a bit longer.
Yes,
because the expectation is less or different.
Yes. Exactly. I mean, the expectation is so in that sense, it may be easier to develop an attractive relationship with a pet robot than with a humanoid robot. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yes.
And a related question about the ICAM specifically was whether the robot was designed to look like a baby to provoke an empathetic feeling towards the robot that is learning new things.
Yeah.
Another way of seeing is like, maybe again, because the robot might not be able to do many things, but the fact that it looks like a baby maybe would be still more, making it more attractive.
Yes. That was a specific choice for when we designed the ICAM. Yes, to have it like a child. Well, you know, we were interested in development, so we started with the idea of developing or realizing a robot child, let's say a small one. But yes, we considered also the fact that in order to be lower the expectations, you may need to give it the shape of a child because of that. Yes, it's less imposing. You know, if you see a 2 meters tall humanoid, you are scared. You know, if you see a small humanoid with just a few human traits, you know, in the face, then you expect less and you interact more. More easily.
Yeah. Indeed. There is another question. By the way, yeah, thanks for the talks, which indeed was really interesting in terms of understanding how to build a relationship between human and the robot. And in that respect, the question is, which methods of communication do you think are the most important?
Well, you know, this is an odd question. I mean, I don't think there is a hierarchy. Of course, I mean, speech is very important because somehow it's a very wide bandwidth. You know, you can convey a lot of information through speech. Also through gestures, but is usually not as rich as speech. You know, so if one goes for the bandwidth, then probably speech is the best one. But it is not natural. I think it is important to interact, but I don't think it can give you the feeling of a relationship in the sense that we feel it as humans. We talk to cars, you know, we talk to PCs, you know, we try to have a speaking relationship with this, but the gestural part is I think is the more natural, and in fact is the bootstrap of social relationship is more on gestures, is definitely on gestures and not on speech, you know. Maybe sounds, but not speech. So in some sense, I think I prefer gestures because it seems to me that is more, you can try to implement it in a more incremental way, you know, a little bit at a time, while for speech, you need to, you know, really understand the meaning of what a person is saying, not only single words. And this is very difficult. And I have the impression that in order to reach that level, you need also to think about a body, not only about you know, an abstract speaker, you know, but a speaker with a body would be necessary to really interact even with voice. So at least the model of the body of the speaker must be explicit in the speaker, even if the body is not there.
Yeah, that's yeah. It's also interestingly what robots could provide than many other machines could not. So there is. So I liked that you mentioned the, let's say, the relationship between correlation and causality, and also citing Joshua Banjo. You mentioned how in many cases, or in most cases, deep learning is about learning correlations, but not necessarily, but often not causality. And causality is it's very important actually for us to understand how the world works. Yeah. And there is a question about that, on whether you know of works in which causality can be also integrated within deep learning architectures. And specific techniques, more let's say based on, for example, MCMC, which I guess it's Monte Carlo methods, or let's say Markov methods.
Markov, yeah.
So I don't know if you have. So maybe this is a bit technical, but
yeah. Well, you know, I don't have the, you know, details about these. I don't know very much about these methods by themselves. But what I think really is that they can be useful and they can be applied, and people is doing that. But if you want to reach the level that we are talking about, ability to predict or, you know, to find implement causality, then you have to think to this method included in an architecture. So you need something else. They can be useful, but you need let's say the right kind of memory, for example, you know, right, how to access the memory of the data that you have. So that is the reason why I really think that the architecture is important. So because it refers not only to a single method and to a single solution, but also to what you need to support that solution. You know, if, so in that sense, I think it is really a step forward. So. Again, I mean, this just because people don't want people to get the wrong impression that you know, you can be an expert of a methodology and still invest your time in thinking about which is the architecture you have in mind. You know?
Yeah.
So this I think is important because everybody, you know, working in cognition, I think has his or her own ideas of how, you know, the overall cognitive process works, you know, maybe a little bit more or a little bit less, but implicitly, you know, even a neuroscientist working on visual system, he has an idea, you know, driving his research on how the brain works, you know. We should make this explicit when we discuss about what we do, you know, to try to see not only how the individual pieces are implemented, but how they are linked to each other.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. I think and I really liked in some of the, let's say, ingredients that you put there in your talk, the fact of looking at the big picture. I think it's always good, and especially as a, let's say, a reminder for students and PhD students, sometimes it's always good to like take a breath and look from a bit above to how what you're doing fits possibly a bigger picture. There is another question. Let me read. So there is a fine line. Presumably, there is a fine line between introducing weaknesses that are annoying or arouse contempt, and that brings affection. So how can we make sure that the robot picks the right ones? So you mentioned like it might be good to have robots that do mistake. And but as we know, like in interactions, some mistakes might be very annoying for the other party and actually not improving the attraction. So comment on that.
No, I mean, I know this is very hard, of course, you know, because it means that the robot itself, if it makes a mistake, you want the mistake not to be destructive, or disruptive. So what it means is that the robot has to be able to anticipate the effects of what it is doing, so in that sense it's a very strong ability, is cognition itself, predicting the future of what you are doing. And so this one thing, and the other thing is that it is really a personal view, that a personal situation that the robot has to be able to understand itself, which is even more difficult than, a robot is interacting with a person who may like to drink wine or may like to drink beer. So this is important to decide, but this cannot be pre-coded somehow. We have to think about methods which are implemented that can give the robot the ability to understand if an action has been a pleasure or has been something different. So this is one of the topics that some people is working on more specifically on trying to adapt internal. But I mean, if you look at gesture, I mean, if I ask you if I ask you a question which I know is going to put you in difficulties, I can understand implicitly from your reactions if this is true or not. For example, if now I say "Viva Sampdoria," you see,
I was laughing, and you know that it's
yes, you laughed, but it was not coming from your heart. It was just a movement of your mouth and eyes.
Yeah, no, I think, and I mean, so many of the things that you discussed, I think, are, of course, very challenging with robots, but incredibly important, such as this mutuality. And you mentioned the importance of memory in the interaction, but I think it's actually very important how that memory is used. Because, of course, you can have a robot that, for example, remembers a previous interaction with a user, and every time it sees that user, it will just talk about all those previous interactions, right? That will be very easy to implement, but it will not be exactly what you will
No,
like.
but I think I you see, I think that it is important to see these problems as somehow individual. I mean, the idea of the architecture, is that it allows you to think about a specific problem, but not by itself, included in a schema, in a larger schema, no? Which I think is the only way to try to sort of generalize what you are doing. You cannot implement the whole architecture all by yourself. You know, you can implement maybe one part of the architecture, but you need to have a guide in mind. So in that sense, you know, for young researchers working in the field, they should not have the feeling that they need to solve a huge problem, you know, because this is going to be impossible, you know. But they need to solve an important problem in a big schema, you know, and then the schema has to be shared with others. So that you know, it fits in the overall.
Yeah, no, I agree. And in that sense, I think it's also very interesting what you mentioned in the very end, this initiative starting from your group and led by Anna Taneska at this moment. And similar initiatives, I think, are very interesting too.
Yeah, I mean, this is open. I mean, it started in IIT and it's trying to follow the path we followed for realizing the ICAB.
Yeah.
But this time working on the architecture, so it is an open initiative.
Very good. Okay, I think we can. So maybe there is a last question. So since the training data of mutual interaction is very limited and difficult to collect, I think the point is you mentioned how important it is for the, let's say, for the robots to then let's say adapt its interaction to a user, but then of course the amount of interaction that can be happen is maybe limited. And so how do we solve this? Should we have
Well, I mean, as I was saying in my second slide, I don't have answers. No, I mean, this is an easy thing. I would not concentrate very much on the word efficiently, because we really don't know how to do that, even inefficiently, you know. It is really an important issue. Is the core of development, you know, of human development, you know, this, you know, and it takes a few years in humans, you know, to be able to interact efficiently, you know, with another human. So I would remove the word efficiently, and I would really put that as a goal of a research project.
But yeah, a quick comment. I think this is also related to something you mentioned. So the difficulty in general of the learning system that we know how to use in computation, the difficulty to generalize, right, to reuse information. And clearly, when we interact with a specific individual, we reuse information taken from other interactions, right? And our abilities to understand what can be, what generalizes, right? What is that we can transfer from one interaction to the other? Because some things are specific and some things are general. And I think humans are very good at that, and we still don't know how do we do it. So it's really difficult to do it in a robot. But.
Yeah. That's the reason why I think we need to look in parallel what I mean, if people is interested in implementing a system somehow taking inspiration from humans, the two streams of research has to progress in parallel.
Okay, I think we can close here. It was great, very, very interesting. A lot of point of discussions, and probably we could go on for a week discussing. I think it's lunchtime, so we should probably stop.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Giulio. Okay.
Yes, thank you, Lorenzo, and thank to all people that were listening and asking questions.
Yes, and well, just let me remind everybody that this one is going to be recorded, and I'm sure some people will also look at the recordings and of course, as Giulio mentioned, if you want more details about any of the topics that have been touched upon, you can just Google for Giulio's name and for the group in IIT, and you will find a lot of resources available to know more details.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much again.
Okay. Ciao.
Ciao, ciao.
Ciao. Ciao, Lorenzo.